Good morning to all of you. I, Dr. Tanya Bose, welcome you back to the fourth session of live online workshop on MATLAB, an introduction with applications. I hope you are understanding the sessions. Keep your notes ready so that as soon as we join university, you can practice at the Edison Lab. Now, yesterday we saw how data is handled and we learned about two and three dimensional plots. Before I start with today's session, let me test your previous knowledge. So be ready for the quiz. And here comes the first question. Mark your option. So now I close the poll. So 73% of you have marked the option as blue, and it is the correct one. The second question, please mark your option. So I close it now. So you have 50% of you have marked as option A and 50% have marked it as option B. So which one is the correct one? It's the first option. Okay. So now we have the third one, the third question. Mark your option. I close this question now. So 65% have marked it as false, and this is the correct one. As mesh plot is not done for curling the areas within the mesh line, it is the command surface, SURF. Mesh plot only plots the lines, right? Okay. So now we go to the next question, the fourth one. Mark your option. So I close the question here. So 83% have marked it as true, and this is the correct option. And the last question for today's quiz. And now I close it. So 81% have marked the second option, just the two letters high, and that is the correct one. So inverted commas, whatever is written within the inverted commas, only that is displayed on the output. So good. So the ones who have got all the correct options, congratulations to them. Okay. Now, I begin with today's session. The outline of my today's talk would be programming in MATLAB, and then the second section would cover the applications of MATLAB in solving the polynomials. Okay, so we begin with the first section, programming in MATLAB. Now, first of all, what are conditional statements? A conditional statement, it is just a command that helps MATLAB to make a decision whether to execute a group of commands that follow the conditional statement or to skip those commands. So if the expression is true, a group of commands that follow that statement are executed, but if that expression is false, the computer skips the group, right? Okay. So let's go through the first conditional statement, the structure of if end conditional statement. So let us look at the flowchart first. So if I have, there is a decision box. So if there is a if statement from the decision, either it will be true or it will be false. So if it is true, it will execute the group of commands that are written here, right? And then it will end. But if this if statement is false, then it will end automatically. So that is why the structure, it is called a if end conditional statement. If it is true, it will execute the commands and end. If it is false, it will automatically end your program. So this is how we write it in a script file. We, whatever program we are writing, these are the group of commands in the beginning. Then we are making the conditional expression of if. Then we have a set of commands here that if it is true, it will obey these rules. And then it will end. And then finally, the next set of MATLAB program is written here, right? So it is if an end is executed like this. So you can see that the alignment of if and end are together. So when you write a program, it is the beauty of how you write the program, right? So that you can identify at the end if there is some problems or there are some errors in it, you cannot easily debug it. So the beauty lies in your hand, how you want to write the program. So let us quickly go through the structure of the if end statement. As the program executes, it reaches the if statement. If the conditional expression in the if statement is true, true means the value 1, the program continues to execute the commands that follow the if statement all the way down to the end statement. But if the conditional expression is false, the program skips the group of commands between the if and the end and continues with the commands that follow the end statement, right? Okay. So this was about the if end conditional statement. We go to the next statement, that is if, else, and end. So this is the second conditional statement. Let us look at the flowchart. So we have an if statement first. There will be two outcomes. Either it will be true or it will be false. If the if statement is true, then it will execute the first group of commands and then it will end. But if it is false, then what it will do? It will execute the second group of commands program, right? Okay. So there is some network problems today, so the network is getting lost in between. I hope it is visible now. Okay. Now, let me give the explanation here. It includes two conditional statements, if and else if, that makes it possible to select one out of the three commands for execution. Okay. The first line is an if statement with a conditional expression. If the conditional expression is true, the program executes the first group of commands between the if and the else if statement and then skips to end. If the conditional statement is in the if statement is false, the program skips to the else if statement. If the conditional expression in the else if statement is true, the program executes the second group of commands between the else if and else and then skips to the end. If the conditional expression in the else if statement is false, the program skips to the else and executes the third group of commands between else and end. Okay. So now we move to the next one. That is the switch case statement. The switch case statement is another method that can be used to direct the flow of program. It provides a means for choosing one group of commands for execution out of several possible groups. So how do we use the switch case statement? The first line is the switch command, which has the form switch, and we write the expression here. Following the switch command are one or several case commands. Each has a value next to it, an associated group of commands below it. After the last case command, there is an optional otherwise command followed by a group of commands. The last line must be an end statement. So what happens here? We have a switch expression, and then there are certain cases which gives you the options. So out of all the cases, one of the case can be picked, and at the last we have to write the end statement. Okay. So let's see the working of a switch case statement. So this is how we write switch, and we write the expression here. Suppose I want to convert some energy units into joules. So there can be many other units also. I can convert it into other units also. So all those values can be given in these cases. So according to the question, whichever units I want to convert, the program will click according to the switch case, and at the end it will end. And at the end we have some other commands written here. So this is how we write the switch case statement, right? Okay. Now, working of switch case statement, the value of switch expression in the switch command with the values that are next to each of the case statements. If a match is found, the group of commands that follow the case statement with the match are executed. If there is more than one match, only the first matching case is executed. If no match is found and the otherwise statement is present, the group of commands between otherwise and end is executed. And if no match is found and the otherwise statement is not present, none of the command group is going to get executed. So a case statement can have more than one value. This is done by typing the values in the form. We can write it like this: value 1, comma value 2, comma value 3, comma so on. The case is executed if at least one of the values matches the values of the switch expression, right? So just go through it. Okay. So now we move to the next conditional statement, that is loops. Now, loop is another method to alter the flow of a computer program. In a loop, the execution of a command or a group of commands is repeated several times. Each round of execution is called a pass. In each pass, at least one variable, but usually more than one, or even all the variables that are defined within the loop are assigned new values. Is my voice coming to all? Is my voice audible to all? Okay. So now, I repeat the loop command. A loop is another method to alter the flow of computer program. In a loop, the execution of a command or a group of commands is repeated several times consecutively. Each round of execution is called a pass. In each pass, at least one variable, but usually more than one, or even all the variables that are defined within the loop are assigned new values. So we have two kinds of loops. First is the for end loop, and the second one is the while end loop. So we have two loops, the for end loop and the while end loop. The structure of the for end loop. So this is the structure of the for equal to f:s:t. We have certain group of commands written here and then we end it. So it is a for and end loop. Now, in this, k is the loop index variable. F is the value of the first pass that we are giving. S is the increment in each pass. And t is the value of k in the last pass. So we suppose if I write k is equal to 1 colon 2 colon say 10. So that means k will have the first value as 1. The next value would be 1 plus 2, that is 3. The next value will be 3 plus 2, that is mark the last term as 10. So the last value that k will take will be 10, right? Okay. So now working out the for end loop. In the first pass, k is equal to f, that is the first term, and the computer executes the commands between the for and the end commands. Then the program goes back to the for command for the second pass. Then k obtains a new value equal to k is equal to f plus s. S means the increment that it takes in each pass. And the commands between the for and the end commands are executed with the new value of k. The process repeats itself until the last pass where k is equal to t. Then the program does not go back to the for, but it continues with the commands that follow the end command. Now, we have to keep certain things in mind while we are working with the for end loop. The first point that is to be kept in mind is the increment s can be negative. So we can give positive increments also and we can give negative increments also. If the increment value s is omitted, the value is always taken by default as 1. If f is equal to t, the loop is executed once. T means the last value. So if f becomes equal to t, then it will be executed only once. Now if f is greater than t and s is greater than 0, that means if the first term is greater than the last term and the increment is greater than 0, or if the first term is less than the last term and the increment is less than 0, then the loop will never be executed. So we can also give in for command the values of k as, instead of giving that k for f colon t, we can also give it in the form of a row vector like we have given it here. So it will only take these particular values, right? And then the value of k should not be redefined within the loop. So when this loop is working, the value of k should not change again. And each for command, it should end with the end command. So if I go back to the previous one, so you can see that with every for, there should be a corresponding end, right? Otherwise, it will give you an error. Okay. So this is about for end loop. Now let's see what is a while end loop. What is the structure of a while end loop? While end loops are used in situations when looping is needed, but the number of passes is not known in advance. So if you know that these are the definite number of passes that will work in your program, you can use the for end loop. But if you don't know about the number of passes in advance, then you can use the while end loop. The number of passes is not specified when the looping process starts. Instead, the looping process continues until a stated condition is satisfied. So this is the major difference between a for end and a while end loop. So if the number of passes you know in advance, when you start with your program, you always use a for end loop. But if the number of passes are not known in advance and it is not specified to you when the looping process starts, you always use a while end loop, right? Both the workings are same, right? So the looping process generally continues till the stated condition. So this is the structure of your while end loop. Again, every while statement will end with the end statement. So we have while, there's a conditional expression written here, and we write a group of commands in between which needs to be satisfied before that condition ends, right? Okay. So working of a while end loop. The first line is a while statement that includes a conditional expression. When the program reaches this line, the conditional expression is checked. If it is false, MATLAB skips to the end statement and continues with the program. But if it is a true statement, MATLAB executes the group of commands that are between the while and the end commands, and then MATLAB jumps back to the while command and checks the conditional expression. This looping procedure continues until the conditional expression is false. So whenever it has to iterate between certain number of values, we always use a loop, right? Okay. Now let's look at this example for a while end loop. See, this is a script file where I'm writing x is equal to 1 semicolon while x is less than equal to 15, x is equal to 2 into x, and then end. So whenever you write a program in your script file with the conditional expressions, you will always get such marking. So this will let you know that is your looping process or is your conditional statement complete. Because if you write a while and if you forget to write the end, it will always give you an error. So if you're writing while with your end, this shows that it is being closed, right? So now how will it work? So first of all, x will take an initial value as 1. Then the next command is executed only if x is less than equal to 15. So when x is equal to 1, x, the new value of x is 2 into 1. So the new value of x will become 2. So it will end here. Again, it will go to this loop. It will check, is 2 less than equal to 15? It will say no. So it will go to the next step. Again, the new value of x will be 2 into 2, that is 4. It will again end here. Again, it will go to this statement. It will ask, is 2 less than equal to 15? It will say no. So it will again go to the next step. So the new value of x is 2 into 4, that is 8. It will end here. Again, it will go to the next. It will again go to the while statement. It will check, is 8 less than equal to 15? It will say no. So it will go to the next step. So the new value of x will be 2 into 8, so it will be 16. Now when it goes again to the while statement, it checks that is 16 less than equal to 15? It will say, is 16 less than equal to 15? No, 16 is greater than equal to 15. So it will end here, right? So when x is equal to 16, the conditional expression in the while statement is false and the looping stops, right? So in the command window, when you execute this program, you will get your output as x is 2, x is 4, x is 8, and x is equal to 16, right? So you got the difference. What is the difference between a for end loop and a while end loop? So here, see, I did not know how many passes it will go through. So that is why I did not use the for end loop. The number of passes were not known to me. So I have used a while end loop here, right? Okay. Let's go through some examples of these conditional expressions. The first example is sum of a series. Suppose I want to calculate the sum of the first n terms of the series, summation k equal to 1 to n minus 1 raised to power k multiplied by k divided by 2 raised to power k. So there is a question here. Suppose you want to calculate this sum. So you can see that the summation runs from k equal to 1 to n. So which loop should I use? Should I use a for end loop or should I use a while end loop? So let's have a quick poll. So please give your options. Okay, so I close the question here. So around 52% of you have said for end loop. So So this is the correct one because I know that it will only go through these number of passes. So this is clear to me that the number of passes are known to me and hence I will use a for end loop, right? Okay. So let me go through the program. So I have written comment sum of the series. So this tells me that this is the name of the program. You can also avoid this. It's no need to write. Now, I'm writing n. See, n I don't know. So I have to ask the user what should be the value of n. So this, I want an input. So I'm writing n is equal to input. Enter the number of turns, colon. So the whoever runs the program, the user will be asked about the number of turns, right? Then I'm initializing the sum s is equal to 0. In the first step, s is equal to 0. Then I'm using a for end loop. I'm writing that k will take values from 1 to n. So you can see that k is equal to what will be the new value of s? S will be the old value plus this value minus 1 raised to power k multiplied by k divided by 2 raised to power k. And the looping will end when this whole process is done till the sum of n terms are calculated. And then at the end, I want to print my answer. So if you remember last lecture, we did sprintf command. And in that also, I told you how to print a string and how to print a mix of string as well as if you want some numbers to be displayed on your print command, right? So if you recall that lecture, how do we write sprintf in inverted commas? I'm writing the sum of the series is colon and I'm writing percentage f. So if you remember yesterday's lecture, percentage f, it will denote the place where I want to make the MATLAB understand that at this place I want to write the sum. And then which sum should I write here? This is the variable that I want to display at this position, right? So percentage s marks the position where I want to write the sum. And which variable whose sum is to be written here? That is written along with in commas. So comma s. So whatever value I get for s, that will be written at this place. So this is how we write in sprintf command, right? So we set the sum equal to 0 and in each pass, one element will be calculated and it will be added to the previous sum, right? So let's look at the output of this program. So when I execute this command, in my command window, since you can see that the name of this program is series sum, so when I execute, when I press the run button, in the command window, it will show series sum. It will go to the script file. The first line is input the number of terms. So see, it is asking me enter the number of terms. Suppose I have entered the number of terms as 4. So k will take values from 1 to 4. So it will, the loop will continue till 4 steps and the sum is calculated. And you can see how the sprintf command is working. See, series is colon. It is writing like that only. The sum of the series is colon. And you can see we have written percentage f. So percentage marks the position where I want to write the sum. And f is the flow point notation. So we have written, the answer is right, 0.125000, right? Now suppose if I re-execute this program again, so again you can see it is writing series sum. It is again asking me enter the number of terms. Now I have entered the number of terms as 20. So now k will take values from 1 to 20 and now the series sum is calculated as minus 0.22221, right? So this is how the for end loop works in MATLAB. Right? I think this program is clear. How to calculate. Okay. We move to the next example. We need to determine the value of e to the power x using Taylor series. So let me recall what is e to the power x. It is summation n going from 0 to infinity x raised to power n divided by n factorial, right? Now the program also wants you to do the way like this. The program calculates e to the power x by adding terms of the series and stopping when the absolute value of the term that was added last is smaller than 0.0001. And if in the 30th pass, the value of term added is not smaller than this number, the program should stop and it should display a message that more than 30 terms are needed, right? So the program needs to calculate the value of e to the power x till the absolute value of the term that has been added in the last step is not smaller than this, right? And there is a condition also that if the 30th pass value is smaller than 0.0001, the program should stop and it should display this message, right? Now, there is a question again. Which loop do you think should be used now? I don't know how many passes are there, right? So let's go to the poll section and let me ask you this question. Which loop can be used here? Quickly give your answers. So let me close the question now. So 92% of you are saying it's a while loop, correct? We will be using a while loop. Let's see how to use this while loop. Okay. Look at the program, the script file. So first of all, what is not known to me in this x? I should know what is x, right? So x is equal to input, enter x, right? Then I want my iteration n equal to 1. Then the absolute value an is equal to 1. And then x is equal to, the sum should be equal to an, right? Okay, so this is my answer or the value of an. I'm taking it as 1 initially. And I'm marking that s, the sum of that series, is equal to an. Now, I'm using a while end loop. So let me check what are all the conditions for the while end loop. If the absolute value of an is greater than equal to 0.001 and n is less than equal to 30, then what it should do? It should calculate the term. This term it should calculate x to the power n by n factorial. So we are writing an is equal to x to the power n divided by factorial n, semicolon. And then the sum should change. S should be the old sum plus an. So at every pass, the sum value, each term will be calculated from the step and it will be added to the sum. Then I also want that n should iterate, it should change value in every pass. So n should be equal to n plus 1. And then the loop ends here, right? So every time, suppose n is 1, it will do all these things, then n will become 2, it will go on to this step, right? Till n is less than or equal to 30. Then, there is a if statement used here. If you look at the statement, it said that if in the 30th pass, the terms added is not smaller than this, the program should stop and display a message that more than 30 terms are needed. So if n is greater than or equal to 30, you display the message more than 30 terms are needed. So what is of an inverted comma? And then if this is the statement, it will display it. Else it needs to print the series sum. So f printf exponential. See how am I writing this step? It is very important. Exp is exponential. In brackets, I'm writing percentage f equal to percentage f, then comma x comma x. What does this line mean? Percentage f means the position where I want to display my answer. Equal to, this is also percentage f, Here also I want to display my answer. But you can see that after this, I am putting a comma sign and am I writing two different variables here. That means the value of x will be displayed here and the value of s will be displayed here, right? So it will give me that exponential, whatever x I have entered, that value will be written here, equal to whatever is the sum value, it will be written here, right? And then I'm also writing f print f, the number of terms used is percentage I n. Now what does it mean? Percentage f was the position of that number and the character should be float point number, right? And when I'm writing percentage I, the position is denoted by percentage and I means the character integer. So and you can see that I've written here slash n. I told you about this command yesterday, that if I don't give slash n, both these lines will be displayed together without any gap. So if I want to display them in two different lines, in the beginning of the second statement, I have to write slash n, right? So let's look at the output of this statement. See, when I run this, the name of the script file is exponential. So you can see that exponential is written over here. And then it will go to the program. It is the first line of the program says x, input x, right? Sorry, enter x. So suppose I have entered the value 2. So x is equal to 2. It will, the while end loop will process. And then what is my answer? F print f, what will this print? Exponential, what value is to be written here? The value of x. So the value of x is 2. So you can see that it is written as exponential 2, and since it's a float point notation, so we're writing it as 2.000000, right? And then it is equal to, there was an equal to sign here, and percentage f, the second position marks for s. What is the sum? The sum is 7.389046. Clear? And it also displays the second message, that how many terms were used in this. So you can see that in the next line, the next statement is being displayed. The number of terms used is the value of n. How many times did n be counted? How many passes it happened here? So in this case, n is equal to 12, right? Suppose I re-execute this program again. So again, I've written here exponential. Now suppose I've entered the value of x as minus 4. You can see that the output is exponential minus 4 is equal to 0.018307. And the number of terms used here is 80, right? So this is an example to demonstrate the loop while end, right? And also I've used here if else statement, conditional statements also, right? Okay, so you can see that if else end, the second conditional statement that we studied today. Okay. Section of my today's talk. Now the second section, applications of MATLAB in solving the polynomials. Now the ones who don't have a maths background, what are polynomials? Polynomials are expressions of the form. You can see this expression. So we have the constant term, then we have x, then we have x squared, so on up till xn minus 1 and xn. And every term has some coefficient associated with it. So all these coefficients, an, an minus 1, so on up till a naught, they are real numbers. And n, it's a non-negative integer. And n is called the degree or the order of this polynomial, right? So in MATLAB, when I want to represent this polynomial, I have to put the coefficients of the polynomial in the form of a row vector. And we saw in arrays how to the first element in your row vector should always be the coefficient of x with the highest power, right? And suppose if some coefficient is missing, suppose this term is not present, xn minus 1, then in place of xn minus 1 place, you have to put a 0, right? So all the coefficients from an to a0 should be present in your row vector. If anyone is missing, then it will give you a different polynomial, right? Okay. Let's look at this representation. Suppose we have a polynomial 8x plus 5. I will write it as polynomial p is equal to, look at the coefficient, this is a polynomial of degree 1. The highest value of x is 1. The degree of x is 1 here. And then I will write 5. Look at the second polynomial, 2x squared minus 4x plus 10. So this is a polynomial of degree 2. So I will start from degree 2. So I will write 2, then minus 4, then 10. Right? Look at the third one, 6x squared minus 150. So this polynomial has degree 2, but it is incomplete because the coefficient of x is not given. So how will you write it in MATLAB? You will write it as 6, 0, minus 1. Clear? Okay. Now let's see how to get the values of a polynomial. That means if I want to evaluate the polynomial at a command is used. The command used is polyval p, x. P denotes the coefficients of the polynomial and x denotes the value where I want to compute my polynomial. Right? Let's look at an example. Suppose we have a polynomial px. You can see that this polynomial has degree 5. And I want to calculate the value of the polynomial at the point 9. So how am I going to do it? It's very simple. P is equal to, first of all, I need to define this polynomial. So p is equal to, start from the highest coefficient. It is 1, then minus 12.1. 40.59, then minus 17.015, then minus 71.95, then 35.88. So I'm putting a semicolon, so it will not be displayed. And then the command used is polyval p, 9. So it is very user friendly since you are calculating the value of the polynomial. So it is writing it as polyval. So write it as p, 9. So in place of x, 9 will be put and your answer is, right? Okay. Now let's look how to calculate the roots of a polynomial. The roots of a polynomial, they are the values of the argument for which the polynomial becomes equal to 0. So how to calculate it? We write r is equal to, it is the variable which has been named for roots. R is equal to roots and you write the p. P stands for the polynomial. So r will be the column vector with the roots of the polynomial and p will be a row vector with the coefficients of the polynomial. So let's look at an example. Suppose you want to calculate the roots of the polynomial x squared minus 2x minus 3. I'm sure the ones who are from maths background, they have calculated the roots also till now. Let's see how we are going to do it in MATLAB. So let me define my vector p, the polynomial p. P is, start from the highest degree, 1, minus 2, minus 3. So the command used is r is equal to roots p. So the roots of this polynomial are 3 and minus 1, right? Let's calculate the roots of this polynomial. So this was quite easy. Now let's calculate the roots of the polynomial with degree 5. So first of all, I'm defining my polynomial and then I'm writing r is equal to roots p. And you can see that the all the 5 roots, so whatever is the degree of a polynomial, that many roots we will obtain here, right? So you can see there are 5 roots in your answer. Now, next we move on to, so in the previous slide from the polynomial, we were calculating the roots. Now how to calculate the polynomials from the roots, the opposite way. So if the roots are given to you, how to calculate the polynomial from there? So the command used is polynomial p is equal to poly and you write the roots here, right? Let's see. P will be the row vector of the polynomial and r will be a vector with the roots of the polynomial. Let's take an example. So my roots are, I'm doing the previous question only. So these were the roots. So I've defined my roots like this. And then I'm giving the command poly R. So when I press enter, I get the coefficients of my polynomial. So this will be my constant of, this will be the coefficient of x, this will be the coefficient of x squared, x cube, x to the power 4, x to the power 5. Right? Okay. Next is how to do simple addition and subtraction using polynomials. So the two polynomials can be added or subtracted by adding or subtracting the vectors of the coefficients. But in this case, if the polynomials are of the same order, then it is easy to do it. But suppose there is a polynomial of suppose degree 5 and there is another polynomial of degree 2, then you need to modify the shorter vector by adding zeros in front of the shorter vector, right? Let's take an example. Suppose you have a polynomial px of degree 6 and there is a polynomial qx with degree 3. So the orders are not same. This is a shorter polynomial, right? So how are we going to add them? Let us see. So first of all, I'm defining the polynomial p. We start with the highest degree, 3, 15. Since the coefficient of x to the power 4 is missing, so I've written here 0, then minus 10, then minus 3, then 15, and then minus 40. Then let me define the polynomial q. It is 3. Then the coefficient of x square is missing, so I'm writing 0 here. And then minus 2 and minus 6. So now how to add them? Since they are of not of same degree, how have I written it? R is equal to, so R is the new polynomial, which will be the sum of the two polynomials. It will be P plus C, 1, 2, 3, 4. So if you go from here, 1, 2, 3, 4. So till here it is complete. So you need to add three zeros in front of it. So we have added three zeros. We have modified the shorter vector by adding zeros. And then I'm writing Q. So now when I compare it with my P, the number of elements in both the polynomials are same, right? You can also do it like this. You can define Q by putting zeros in front of it, by writing three zeros in front of it. So either way you can do it. Now when you add them, the coefficients at the same places will get added. The resultant polynomial will be this, right? So similarly, you can do for subtraction also. Now let's see how to multiply two polynomials. For multiplication, we use the command conv, C-O-N-V, and you write A comma B. So C is the vector of the coefficients of the product of the polynomial. And A and B are the coefficients of the polynomials that need to get multiplied. So let's go through the same example. So we have P and Q. So I have defined P and Q. Now here order doesn't matter. So P and Q have been defined like this. And then PM is the product matrix, product polynomial. It's conv P comma Q. So when I give this command, I get a polynomial. What will be the order of the polynomial? 6 into 3, it's 9. 6 plus 3, sorry, 9. So it will give you a polynomial of degree 9, right? So you can see we get these coefficients. So this will be when we multiply the two polynomials, right? Okay. So you can write the polynomial as 9x to the power 9 plus 45x to the power 8 and so on. The last term will be the constant term. So you will get 240 at the end. Okay. Then we have how to divide two polynomials. So we have seen how to add, how to subtract two polynomials. Then we saw how to multiply two polynomials. Now how to divide two polynomials. The command used is q comma r. Q will tell you what is the quotient when we divide the two polynomials, and r shows what is the remainder when we divide the two polynomials. So the command used is dconv. U comma v are the polynomials. So q will be the quotient and r will be the remainder. Okay. So let's take an example. Suppose I want to divide the polynomial u with the polynomial v. So when I give this command, so I need to declare first of all the two polynomials u and v. You can see it is easily defined like this. And then I'm giving the command q comma r is equal to d conf u comma v. So you will see that it is giving q is 2, 3 minus 2 and r is 0, 0, 0, 0. That means it is getting completely divided. The remainder is 0. So from here, I can say that my quotient is 2x squared plus 3x minus 2 and the remainder is 0. Right? Let's take another example. Suppose I want to divide w with z. So first of all, I'm defining w and z. And then I'm giving this command dconf w comma z. So you can see that it is not completely divisible. There is a remainder left. So the coefficients of the quotient are this, and the coefficients of the remainder are this. So you can interpret the answer as the quotient is 2x to the power 4 minus 13x cube plus 10x square plus 10x plus 52. And the remainder is 50x plus 200, right? Okay. Then we have how to calculate the derivative. So polydir means derivative. So polydir of the polynomial will give me the derivative of my polynomial. So k is the vector of the derivative and p is the coefficients of my polynomial. So let's take an example. Suppose I want to calculate the derivative of f and function 3x squared minus 2x plus 4. So first I need to define my polynomial f1, 3 minus 2 and 4. Let me define the derivative of f1 as f2. So I'm giving the function the command polydir f1. So if I quickly calculate its derivative, what it should be 6x minus 2. So you can see that the coefficients are 6 and minus 2. So f2 will be the first derivative of f1, right? Now suppose if I want to calculate the second derivative, so I'm writing f3 is polydir f2. So derivative of x 6x would be 6. So the second derivative will be f3x is equal to 6. Suppose I want to calculate the third derivative. So f4 is polydir f3. So the derivative of a coefficient constant term is 0. So my answer is the third derivative is 0. Right? So this is how we calculate derivative of the polynomials. So we have seen how to calculate the roots of a polynomial, how to calculate the value of the polynomial at a particular point. Then if the roots are given, how to get back the polynomial. And then we have done simple calculus, that is addition, subtraction, multiplication and division using polynomials. And then how to calculate the derivative of the polynomials, right? So with this, I end my session. So see you tomorrow at the same time. Till then, take care. For your queries, you can always drop your mails to this email address. Stay at home and stay safe. Bye.